at the show.
Yes.
The idea of jumping out of airplanes tends to attract interesting kind of people.
That's being born again. Being born again each time. You know,
yes, exactly.
Re-seeking the womb each time you went on the airplane.
Yeah,
yes.
Where is the Imperial College located? Is it?
South Scandinavia.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Yes. It's quite a nice area. Yeah. You were at Imperial, weren't you?
No, I have actually never visited.
No, you never
visited. I've always wanted to, but I never got there.
Oh, yes, oh, yes. But Matthews came here.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Here at Duke? Or
No, at Wisconsin. He was at Wisconsin also.
Wisconsin, yes.
This is one of a series of programs in what is called the Living History Program of Duke University, a series which sponsors interviews with distinguished visitors who come to the campus under a variety of auspices. We're very fortunate in having one of the speakers in a series called the Sesquicentennial Series. This Sesquicentennial honors the 150th anniversary of the founding of Trinity College, which is the antecedent entity of Duke University. We have with us today on the panel two very distinguished scholars from Duke University. One of them is Professor Lawrence Evans, who is in the physics department, specializing in theoretical physics, on my left. Next to him is Professor Louis Dupree, distinguished anthropologist who has spent the major portion of his career living in Afghanistan and in Pakistan, and who indeed has just returned from a six-month tour in Pakistan. I'm Professor Ralph Braibanti of the Department of Political Science and Director of Islamic and Arabian Development Studies. All three of us, and indeed the entire university, feels very fortunate indeed in being able to have with us a very distinguished physicist who is the director of the International Institute of Theoretical Physics in Trieste, Italy, who won the Nobel Prize in 1979. Perhaps I might say a few words about our distinguished visitors before we start this conversation. Dr. Abdus Salam, who is here before me, was born in the district of Jhong in Pakistan. It was then, of course, India under British rule. He was educated at the University of the Punjab, subsequently went to Cambridge University in England, where even as an undergraduate, he won what is called Smith's Prize for the most distinguished work in undergraduate physics. Subsequently, he got his PhD from Cambridge. His honors seemed to come in groups of 30, which is a rather interesting kind of phenomenon. I don't know whether that has anything to do with the laws of physics or not, but he has somewhat more than 30 honorary degrees from countries all over the world, ranging from the Soviet Union to Italy, the Scandinavian countries, and even the University of Edinburgh. He also has something like 30 gold medals and distinctions given him by various governments throughout the world, and further is a member, and indeed in many cases the founder, of something like 30 learned academies also scattered throughout the world. Indeed, only yesterday we received word that he had been awarded the Medal of Science of the City of Edinburgh during their science festival, which is his latest honor. We're very pleased indeed to have Dr. Abdus Salam with us, who is interested not only, I should add, in physics, in theoretical physics, but more recently has been very deeply concerned about the transfer of science and technology throughout the Third World, and has, in a sense, been developing the theme that science and technology should be given much greater emphasis in the Third World than it has been given. He will be moving from Duke University on to Los Angeles, and from Los Angeles to Venezuela, where he'll be attending the inauguration of the new president of Venezuela, who's one of his firmest supporters and a very firm believer in the use of science as an aid to the Third World in the whole development process. So again, we're very pleased to have him, and we welcome him here, and we want to open up this conversation with Dr. Salam.
Dr. Salam, you, of course, are very much interested in science and technology in the Third World, and that implies a strong interest in scientific education in those countries. I thought it might be helpful to us if you would give us an account of your own education during the British occupation period.
Well, I was educated in Jhang, as Mr. Braibanti just told you. I was at school there till about the age of 16, then I moved to Lahore, which is the capital city of Punjab. It used to be capital city of the Punjab in the undivided India, and still the capital of the divided Punjab of Pakistan. I still remember very vividly one occasion when our teacher taught us what has become my specialty, the unification of fundamental forces. He told us about the forces in Jhang. And he said, gravity is one of the important forces, of course. Gravity we had all heard about. And then he took out a magnet from his pocket and he said, this is magnetism. He showed us the iron filings being attracted and so on. Then he remembered to say electricity. He said, electricity. Electricity does not live in Jhang. It lives in Lahore, the nearest place where the electric current was still available. And Jhang had electricity 5 years later, which is true. And then he went on to discuss the forces of nuclear power and so on. And said, oh, well, they live in Lahore, they live in Europe, they don't live in Pakistan here at all. So that was the introduction which I got to the nuclear forces from him. So then from at Lahore, I was studying mainly for the Indian Civil Service examination. That was the biggest examination which was possible for a young student to take. Fortunately for me, the examination stopped during the war. And so I was left to do something different. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question?
Well, partly. At what point did your talent and interest in mathematics become recognized?
Well, mathematics was a good exam spinner. So I had to take that examination for mathematics. Mm-hmm. It was all meant to be examinations. So Indian Civil Service examination was meant to be the final objective of my studies. My father had taught me that earlier on in my life. And so I was been preparing for the mathematics examination from that point of view. Mm-hmm. Although I showed a little bit of inventiveness in solving one of the problems of Ramanujan when I was about 14 or 15. Mm-hmm. This was published, but that was just a sort of flourish of the inconsequential type. Then I came to Cambridge, mm-hmm. and that's where I really became interested in science. Mm-hmm. And then I never looked back on that.
How was it decided that you would go to Cambridge?
Well, that's another story. That's another interesting story because it wasn't decided for me, it was decided by the powers that be, in the sense that here was a young student who had done well in his examinations in the Punjab. And fortunately for me, as I told you, the civil service examination was suspended. Mm-hmm. So just after the war, 46, was the time when I was finished with my MA, and the question was what I should be doing next. I was thinking of civil service, Indian civil service examination, but it was decided by various friends of mine that it would be good if I went to Cambridge to complete my studies. Now, how to get to Cambridge was the difficulty. Mm-hmm. How do you get a scholarship for that? I was a very poor family, came from a very poor family, and so there was the difficulty of getting the money. Fortunately, at that time, one of the politicians of the Punjab, the old Punjab, undivided Punjab, had collected a lot of money for the war. And during that, since the war finished, he did not know what to do with the money. So he constituted some scholarships. 5 scholarships were constituted for overseas studies. Now, since I was fortunate to get one of them with the other 4. But I had taken the precaution of applying to St. John's College, Cambridge, and other colleges before that. Mm-hmm. So I was fortunate enough to be given a place in St. John's College, Cambridge, before the award of the scholarship, while all the others waited for their scholarships to be awarded first, and then to be making applications. Then came the partition, and they lost their scholarships. partition of the country took place and they lost all their scholarships. So I was the only one who ever got that scholarship, that particular scholarship. So my father, who was a very deeply religious man, always used to say that the entire exercise by this Prime Minister of the Punjab to collect the money and to make scholarships and so on resulted in one thing. That was in sending me to Cambridge, which is true. And then I went to Cambridge in 46. I stayed there till 49, doing mathematics and physics. Physics was something which I had not done before, but mathematics was something which I had done before. And Fred Hoyle, you probably heard of him, the great astronomer.
Yes.
He was my teacher, and he was the man who put me on to physics. He said, if you want to do theory, I was already interested in theoretical physics. And he said to me, if you want to do theoretical physics, you must do experimental physics. Otherwise, you'll never look a physicist in the eye. And that was very good advice, very, very true advice.
Very British attitude.
Very British attitude, yes, yes, yes. So I went and did a year's work in physics in the Cavendish. And then I qualified for that. And then 49, I came back to Pakistan after my undergraduate work. And then I was advised by the people who were in charge of the education of the country that it would be good to do a PhD. Mm-hmm. So I went back to Cambridge, 49. 50, I started to do research in renormalization.
Yes.
And then the rest is all well known.
Yes. Well, yes. To me, to me, it's well known. If you were a teenager in Pakistan today,
yes,
what do you think would be the
best advice?
Situation?
Well, again, unfortunately, Pakistan has relapsed very badly in physics. Surprising though it may seem, there are only 46 PhDs altogether in the country for 19 universities. Can you believe that?
Oh, my goodness.
46 PhDs in the whole. And so it's just not done anything in terms of training people. Mm-hmm. So the first thing would be, I would suggest to this young man, he should go abroad, he should come here, or he should go to UK. UK is now out of bounds because of the pricing mechanism. Mm-hmm. The UK fees, which used to be £70 when I was a student, are now £1,000, just the fees. Mm-hmm. They have specially put them up to discourage people from poorer countries to come up. And so the result is that about here is the only place where people can come to. Last year, under my great urging, the Pakistan government made 400 scholarships available, 400, for people to come here. I don't think more than about 200 people were found in the country who were fit to take the scholarships. Mm-hmm. And then to get them over here was itself a problem, so I don't know how many are here now. Yes. Very few, I expect.
This is 200 people in a country of a considerable population.
Considerable, 100 million people,
people.
Yes. Yes, 100 million people. Yes, incredible.
Amazing number.
Small, very, very small numbers.
Yes.
Yes.
How can you characterize the attitude towards science under British rule in undivided India when you were there as a student? We commonly hear, for example, that the whole tradition of education under the British was a literary generalist tradition.
That's right.
Not a scientific tradition.
That's right. Well, that's what I told you a moment ago, that I was meant to be a civil servant. Mm-hmm. From my parents, from everybody wanted me to be a civil servant. And so the result was that all my education was slanted towards taking the civil service examination and doing well in that. And that meant a generalist education. There was no question of any scientific research. Although, mind you, India's one Nobel laureate who really remained Indian and so on was Raman, physicist. He was totally educated in India, completely educated in India. He did his work in India, and he got his Nobel Prize about 1930. So he is an exception to the rule. But he belonged to a generation much before mine. It's a very funny situation that there was research which was encouraged in his day, then in my day it was not encouraged, and then later on now it's not encouraged either. Although independence has taken place and you might think things are different, but now the whole climate has changed again. Raman was doing pure physics, as you know, spectroscopy and so on, and this is changed again now because of the major influence of the West, I should say, where science has become very utilitarian. Everybody judges science on the basis of utilitarianism. And that has permeated to our people too, who have forgotten that when the West speaks of science, there's a vast quantity of people who are really first-rate basic scientists, vast numbers of people who have been trained in basic sciences. We have no training in basic sciences, but we still believe in utilitarianism, mm-hmm. which is very funny to me. Mm-hmm. But the economists don't find it very funny at all, you see.
The connection between the basic science and the technology does seem to be a difficult connection to make for a non-scientist, and I've often wondered why. It is so mysterious. If you're going to use something, you have to really understand it.
Exactly. This is something which people don't understand. People don't understand. Economists particularly are totally impervious to this sort of thing. Yes. Economists are the people I dislike intensely, really, quite honestly.
Yes. Fortunately.
Unfortunately. Yes. For example, there was a very distinguished economist in this country. He got a Nobel Prize for economics. I should perhaps not mention his name, because he may be known to you, many of you. But anyhow, he has a theory of inputs and outputs. And he got a Nobel Prize for that. Now, he was lecturing on this theory of outputs and inputs. And one of the audience caught up. This is something which I witnessed myself. And he asked him, "Sir, how do you explain the introduction of the transistor by your theory? Is there some spike by which the whole thing changes over technologically?" And the man just collapsed. He had never thought of that. Mm-hmm. Never thought of that. You see, his inputs and outputs are just static. There's no place where he could introduce a what we would call a delta function singularity.
Yes.
You mentioned certain periods during the British period that science had been, if not emphasized, at least was in existence, and the Indian winning the Nobel Prize was an exception, of course, to the entire rule. Let's go back a little in time and take a look at when Islam was in the forefront of science, in the forefront of technology, when Europeans were still somewhat backward, shall we say. When would you give us your insight as to what really happened to the Islamic scientific tradition when it began to, shall we say, fade slightly, and then quite a bit, as the European science and technology began to dominate on the world scene?
That's a very good question. But before we discuss this, shall we go over to the place where you mentioned the Indian situation, where the British were actively doing research themselves, and the influence was the Indians also did the same. That was the beginning period of British domination of India. When you may remember, Jones and people wrote dictionaries of Sanskrit and Persian and so on and so forth. They did quite a lot of research. The civil servants were research-minded somehow. That's a very funny period in the history of India. And that's the period which gave a legacy to the scientist, this Raman man, who was sort of propelled by that sort of feeling. But then that faded from the Indian civil service, and it also went down with us. You see, this follows the, as you know, the saying in Arabic is that the people follow the rule of the kings. So we followed the rule of the kings, if you like. Now, coming back to India, coming back to the Islamic period, you're absolutely right. Islam was very, very strongly research-minded for a time, till about 1000, let's say. About 1000, there was the big battle between the Sufis and the theologians. You know the battle between
the Sufis being the mystics, more or less,
the mystics in Islam, yes. The people who were otherworldly and so on, and the theologians. The theologians won that battle. And the result was that the theologians put an embargo on independent thinking. And that's what stayed Islamic science from Well, it was the death of Islamic science. Now, Islam came to India much later. As you probably very well know, it was about 13th century that India became Muslim or ever had any influence of Islam. So we never had any great men of science at all among the great men of science of the Islamic period. This is not recognized, well recognized, because we all take pride in the fact that we are all Muslims and Muslims are universal, and so we take pride in the Iranians and the Arab scientists and so on. Avicenna was a, as you know very well, he came from the Central Asia and so on. Al-Biruni, who was the next man, or Ibn al-Haytham was an Arab and so forth. But we don't realize that we, as Indian Muslims, have never contributed to science at all, because by the time science came to us, it was dead already.
I beg to differ with you. Dr. Abdus Salam is sitting with us now, and he has certainly made a contribution to the entire field of science.
Well, this is, I'm not talking about the present time, sir. I'm talking only of the classical period, which you mentioned a moment ago. But I think this is very, very important to realize that we never had any great scientific geniuses among us. Mm-hmm. We had the Taj Mahals being built, of course, by the Indian Muslims and so on. But that was craftsmanship, if you like, of the very highest order of genius type. But this wasn't creative science as such.
I'm interested that you said that the one reason that Muslim science began to fade somewhat is that the Sufi, the mystics, lost out to the theologians. Are you putting the mystics on the side of the angels of science?
No, I'm not. They're too otherworldly for that reason, for that purpose. But still, they might have been more partial to science and scientific people than the theologians were. Theologians were just too much. Theologians, as you very well know, killed off Al-Hallaj.
Yes.
And they killed off all sorts of other people, Sarmad and so on, who were against them. Against not really the theologians as such, but they were accused of being anti-establishment, anti-state and so forth, and then the kings put them to death. So that's a very, very bad period of Islamic history.
Is it possible that the mystics were, the Sufis were seeking the truth in their own way,
which is what
science is trying to find,
that's right.
And the theologians were trying to find reasons to perpetuate their control over the population
and so forth. You see, Islam doesn't have any specified theologians, but the theologians were still very, very important because you got the stamp of the approval from the seminary, the religious seminary. And so how do you keep control over the population? By branding your enemies as non-Muslims. That's what they keep still doing. Mm-hmm. Yes, as you very well know from Afghanistan, the Afghans are probably busy at that sort of thing than just now. Mm-hmm. You see the Shias among the Afghans are probably not trusted by the Sunnis and so on. And as you very well know, the Shias in Iran have been not very fond of the Sunnis and so forth. So it's all a backlash of that sort of thing.
How can you account for the inconsistency between the lack of emphasis on science in the Muslim world and the fact that you've alluded to before, namely that very substantial portion of the Holy Book of Islam, which after all has been dictated by God himself through the Archangel Gabriel, that holy book known as the Holy Quran puts great emphasis on science.
Well, I don't know how to answer your question, but let's look at today. Today they had a meeting of Pakistani scientists to reflect on this problem. And it was so funny what these people found. These people found was, for example, they tried to determine where the location of paradise is. They tried to determine, one of the suggestions made was that since jinn were fire, they may solve the energy crisis. Can you believe this sort of rubbish? So I don't know what's going on. So can you believe this sort of nonsense? And one of the people who was against this, of course, was some physicists are against this sort of prostitution of modern science in Islamic terms. And this man, Hudbhai, who was a very good physicist, he objected to this, and he went up to one of the European participants in this conference and asked him whether he believed this nonsense himself. And he, of course, said no. And then he said, why are you here? He said, well, I'm paid to be here. So it's a very strange situation. You do what, again, what the state tells you, what the headmaster is liking to hear, you tell them.
Be they British or be they the successors to the British.
That's right. The
educational system today in Pakistan and other Muslim countries where you have been really becoming a prophet of science and technology and the necessity for that. In the educational systems that you've observed in the Islamic world today, would you say that they are virtually the same as existed during the imperialist period, in that you'd indicated that your beginnings in education were to your ideal was to become one of what I call the bookkeepers of empire in the civil service, and yet luckily accidents occurred that pushed you into science, and we're all very, very grateful for that.
Yes.
But what about the modern educational systems?
I don't think much has changed, really, quite honestly. Because the British were not very keen to make us scientists in their last period. They were much more keen, as Macaulay said, to have clerks, glorified clerks or clerks themselves and so forth. And so their educational system was, for example, I was asking one of the young men who was asking me questions yesterday, one of the Indian chappies, had he heard of scientific civil service? He said he had never heard of scientific civil service. I said, that's the thing which has flourished in Britain itself for years and years and years. Now, this is something which is unknown to Indians altogether, because scientific civil service does not exist in India, or was not introduced to India by the British themselves, although they had it in their own country. Or, for example, for that matter, high school national certificate of engineering. Now, that's a degree, that's not a degree, that's a diploma which you get after age of 16. I asked this young man, had you heard of this? He said, no. So the British education system in India was different from the British education system in Britain. And likewise, the possibilities of career patterns are different in Britain than they are in India. Because Britain is, after all, a part of Western countries, Western Europe and so on. And so it took up things from Germany and so on, and copied or led the world in that part of the world for its own purposes. But in India, it was totally different. In India, their objectives were different. And so we have never learned any of these things ourselves to try to introduce, for example, the scientific civil service is not a part of Indian thinking at all, even today. There's no such thing as scientific civil service in India. Although ICS, Indian Civil Service, is an examination which is flourishing even today in the Indian as well as in the Pakistani context, as you very well know. Mm-hmm. These are the people who rule the country. Yes.
Do you still find this kind of possessiveness about, a better word than possessiveness, about the power of scientific ideas on the part of the developed countries with respect to the undeveloped countries? That is, that they would just as soon not see the undeveloped countries develop scientifically?
Well, this is something which I should ask you, really, quite honestly, because I would be accusing you of some things which may not be true. But it is a fact, looking at from the point of view of the developing countries, that there's no great desire on the part of the rich countries to impart what they have learned for themselves, of course, with great difficulty, the scientific and technological milieu. There's no great desire. And the aid agencies, for example, are not very keen, not falling over backwards, to impart to us technical or scientific education. No, that's true. But when I say this, the truth of the matter also is on the other side. We don't know the value of these things as a rule, and we don't ask for these things. For example, the aid agencies are asked, bombarded every day in Italy, for example, to import marble or marble technology, for example, into Pakistan. Mm-hmm. Now, what is marble technology? That's not very deep. Mm-hmm. But that's the sort of thing which is asked for, and the aid agencies fulfill this very happily.
That's why I asked the question, because it was clear from what you said before that the countries themselves have some trouble understanding their own needs in this respect.
Yes.
And I was wondering to what extent they also ran into reluctance on the part of the other people
There is reluctance. I think it may very well be not reluctance of this sort of ideas people, but mm-hmm. reluctance on the part of the actual executants of the... Mm-hmm. They are not very highly educated people, the aid agency people. Mm-hmm. They'll do what they're told. Mm-hmm. And if they're not told this thing, then they will not worry about this sort of thing.
But the system of priorities is quite different.
It's quite different. The priorities, for example, the World Bank. As did the World Bank president, what was his name? The man who was president before this present one.
McNamara was his cousin or something like this.
Mm-hmm. Anyhow, I was talking with him and I mentioned to him that whereas physics is a language of, is the subject of high technology, the chemistry and the biology today are survival sciences in the sense that you provide food using chemistry, chemicals and so forth, pesticides and insecticides and so forth, or biology in the simple-minded pharmaceutical sense and so on. And I said to him that whereas you are, in the World Bank point of view, imparting chemistry and biology, you are not taking physics as such. Physics is the language today of high technology, and if you want to be asked to be wealthy, you should try to take up physics as such. Now this was news to him, and he said this to me quite freely. He said, this is news to me and I will certainly think about it and so on. He may still be thinking about it, in his, but nothing more than that happened. The World Bank still flourishes with its priorities totally different. They are, of course, immediate tasks to be done, immediate hunger to be suppressed, immediate diseases to be looked after and so on. But there should be at least 10% of the proportion of the aid funds or whatever have you, it should be devoted to this sort of thing. And that's the trouble, that they are not being devoted.
If the money were available, in what form would you like to see it used?
Well, I would like to see it purely in terms of grants, like here. Mm-hmm. You see, $3.5 billion would be available at 10% formula. $33 billion is the total amount of aid money, which is now given to the world, by the world, to the developing countries, $33 billion. $3.5 would be available that way. Mm-hmm. And then I would estimate that at the formula of 16% of the education budget of the developing country, another $17 billion would be available in non-foreign exchange side from the developing countries themselves. Mm-hmm. So together this would make about $20 billion. Now with $20 billion you are not going to do very great a deal of work, but still, the $20 billion is $20 billion. Mm-hmm. That's the quantitative aspect of this thing, what I'm requesting the developing countries to think about.
There is now in the U.S. Agency for International Development an enormous project and a very large sum of money to be devoted to education in Pakistan at the secondary and elementary levels.
Uh-huh.
And yet, unfortunately, the bulk of that money is going to be used for training in English, education in English language.
In English language?
Rather than in science.
Good heavens.
This would be a good opportunity for you to consult with the AID people in an effort to urge them to do something at the elementary and secondary levels.
Well, the trouble will be, they'll say, we shall need Pakistanis to put forward suggestions. Pakistani meaning thereby the central government in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. And then I have to go back to the central government and try to make them agree from outside, and that's a very, very difficult task. You see, this has to be done both from the point of view of the AID people here as well as the Pakistanis. If the AID people here say, we shall not give you any monies except for science. That will be very helpful. Mm-hmm. But this they will never do. Just because they are not used to this sort of thing.
Yes.
Yeah. But this is news to me, what you say. How much money is involved?
It's several millions of dollars.
Several millions, several hundreds of millions.
I've forgotten the exact figure, yes.
Hundreds
yes,
of
it's
millions.
It's actually hundreds of millions, yes.
Yes, yes.
It's the largest such project which has ever evolved in the AID mission.
Well, you see, Pakistan. For example, I've been saying that for secondary education it's very, very important in the sense that it's at the secondary level that we do not train enough technical people. What we do is train 90% of our young people to go to the universities, and only 10% of the people are trained in order to take up the technical subjects like, for example, engineering or this sort of thing, or even typing or even masonry or even this sort of thing. Now, this is the big gap, 90-10, whereas in the developed countries it's 50-50. And if we are keen to make 50-50 as our norm, that will be very useful. Mm-hmm. If that was sort of accepted, that 50-50 is the transition which we have to make in terms of education. But at the moment it's 90-100. 90 people after the secondary would go into universities, and 10 only would go into the professions. Now, professional education is a very, very important must. And secondary education, from that point of view, is a very, very crucial area which we have neglected completely in developing countries. This is not only true of Mr. Michael Manley, who is now fighting his election in Jamaica. He was once listening to me over this secondary education business, and he came up with the remark that what you are saying is so obviously true that I must put it into practice as soon as I get into power. I hope he does get into power. But you see, the point is, what we have to do further in our own countries, in our own societies, is to give this secondary level, this professional level, some sort of prestige, so that the parents will take up this system of education also. Now, what is the way to do this prestige? I have suggested that this should be given degrees and diplomas exactly equivalent to the normal ones. There should be a degree in masonry. There should be a degree. Why shouldn't there be? There's one here in this country, I believe. There's a degree should be given for weaving. There should be a degree given for this sort of thing. So that the parent does not feel there's any distinction between this sort of degree as well as the other degree which leads to the university level education. And unless we do this, we are not going to get the parents to agree to their children being taught this way. And this is very, very important.
But don't you think in this regard you have to, in many of the developing countries, let us say India, both India and Pakistan, and even Saudi Arabia, you have to move against a very powerful cultural currents which have indicated that manual work is something almost contemptuous. It is beneath dignity. Even in Saudi Arabia, where they have established technical institutes,
yes,
and they have offered fellowships and indeed salaries for people to go to the technical institutes to learn to be masons, electricians, and so on. Nobody wants to go. Everyone wants to be a businessman. Everyone wants to punch buttons and get someone else to do the manual work. In the case of the Indo-Pakistan subcontinent, don't you think that the influence of the Hindu caste system has greatly affected the Islamic component as well, so that this kind of manual work simply has no dignity and no status?
Well,
hence the introduction of scientific education has to move against those powerful currents. Do you think there's anything
there
to that?
You're absolutely right. Except that my formula, which would confer the same status on the degrees given after these by these polytechnics, whatever they are called. First of all, there should be no distinction between, there should be no different schools, there should be streams of these things, and streams of degrees and so on. And then there should be, the same man should be capable of going into civil service, if he's good enough, if he's got a good degree. So that would be one way of doing this sort of thing. But I totally agree with you that this is more a political, more a social problem than a political problem. to say.
We're not immune from that kind of problem in this country. The parental
really?
Aspirations determining a great deal of social policy.
Really?
Oh, indeed. But
I thought you were quite immune to this sort of thing yourselves.
No, I think not.
Status and money are motivations throughout the entire world, I'm afraid.
Well, status and money is what I'm trying to get to the other stream.
That's the key.
Yes,
these are the keys,
But the idea that your son would be an expert auto mechanic is not the fondest dream of every American parent.
Well, in spite of the status and the money.
In spite of the status and the money.
The status is not coming to the automobile engineer, is there?
Not the status, that's right.
Not the status.
The money they get.
Although the money
get
is,
yes.
But that's the difference. Yes, in my view of things, status should also come to him.
Yes. That's important.
That's important.
But we have the same problem, is all I'm saying.
Well, what about Eastern Europe? They don't seem to have the same problem.
That's correct. In fact,
Yugoslavia,
Europe,
for example, people like money so much more than status that they would be rather be little lumberjacks and people like doing this sort of thing.
And they take pride in being the best.
Being the best.
If I were younger, I'd consider switching the plumbing instead of professoring, I admit, with the prices that come in.
Yes.
But I wanted to ask you about the 90% who go to the university. Now, we're talking about 90% of the people who complete secondary
education,
and I assume that that's already a relatively small fraction of the total population at that age.
Yes. It's about 17% of the total population which is available for that sort of thing at that age. 17% compared to 85% in the rich countries, and compared to 49% for the poor country.
Yes.
For the poor countries as a whole, so we are pulling it down.
It's way, way down.
Yes. And then only 5% complete their degree in our cases, whereas 30% complete their degrees in the rich countries, and 13% complete their degrees in the other developing countries. Mm-hmm. So we are worse off in those terms, relatively speaking, in these areas as well.
Mm-hmm. But I wanted to ask about the 90%. What when they get to the universities, what do they study?
Oh, they study the usual, well, if your question is, do they go 50-50% in sciences and technology versus arts, that's not the case.
No.
The sciences and the sciences they study are mostly two sciences. They are either wanting to become doctors, as probably is true here, or they want to become engineers, engineers of the white-collar sort. That's about all. There's no desire to go into sciences because science doesn't exist as a profession. As I said before, it doesn't exist apart from school teaching. There's no other professional channel which is open for physicists, for example. There's the Atomic Energy Commission, which you may go into or may not. But apart from that, there's no other profession which is open because there's no industry and so forth.
If that's what you want to do, you have really no choice but to leave Pakistan.
But to leave Pakistan, yes.
Isn't it also, is it true, I should ask you this, because it's been a superficial observation of mine, that many of the students who do go into medicine and finally matriculate as doctors end up going into politics instead of medicine. I find that many medical students have used their training to go into politics. Is that a true statement?
Well, that's a true statement up to a degree, but most of all, they would like to go into cities.
Ah.
That's the biggest trouble. They would not like to go into villages.
Mm.
They would not like to open clinics in villages. That's one of the big troubles. Second is, quite rightly, you are saying they go into politics. Politics would not be so bad if they remembered they were doctors. But they don't, usually. Usually they don't.
I wonder if we can go back to a moment to the relationship of Islamic thought to science.
Yes.
One of the great intellectual heroes of Pakistan and of India to some extent has been Allama
Iqbal,
Muhammad Iqbal.
Yes.
And his very famous series of lectures on the reconstruction of religious thought in Islam. Now, do you have any views with respect to his views on the relationship of science to
Islam? Well, he was talking about Ijtihad. You see, I have quoted his one of his chapters.
Which means essentially interpretation, doesn't it?
Reinterpretation of Islam.
Yes.
He was very strongly influenced by Heisenberg and people like that. It's very surprising. He was following the... He was living about... He died in 1938. Mm-hmm. So he was very strongly influenced by the Heisenbergian uncertainty principles and relativity and things and so on.
Having been educated in Germany as he was.
He was educated in Germany as he was. The trouble with his thought, to my mind, is that it's all based on the individual. As you very well know, Khudi and Asrar-e Khudi and these things are individuals, the paramountcy of the individual. That was probably very good for a non-technical age. But for a technical age, as you very well know now, the Japanese and the Confucian examples, it's probably not a very good thing for a technology. For science, it's of course still a good thing. But for technology, well, that's a sociological problem. That I will come to later. But coming back to your question, what was whether his influence has subsisted in terms of scientific thought, it has not. He is mainly considered to be a poet of, or a politician of Pakistan, and that's about all. We have tried to build his image in terms of politics, or in terms of poetry, but not in terms of a man who loved science. That's a very important point that you have made just now. And I'm trying to revive his scientific writings, which are very sparse, of course. He was not a scientist. But he gave utterance from time to time about the primacy of scientific thought and so on. I'm trying to revive those things, and as I said, I've quoted a whole chapter of his at the end of one of my lectures.
Have you been able to talk to his son at all, Javed Iqbal, who's a justice of the Supreme Court?
Yes, he was my class fellow at Cambridge. We were together at Cambridge, and I know him quite well, and he's a very decent man, but of course he is not interested in science as such. He is a lawyer, and he was an interesting person in Cambridge, but that's about all. He's not interested in science as such. Although, mind you, his children are being brought up as scientists.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. That's very interesting, because most of the people would like their children to be brought up as scientists and would like to send them to USA for higher education.
Mm-hmm.
And once they get to USA, what they do here is something which I would like to find out from you. And they go back, there is a very difficult question for them, for the children. I think if you come here or to Britain at a later age, you are more likely to go back. That was a question which was being asked yesterday, and I didn't reply to it properly. But I think that's probably a true observation, that if you come too young here, you are likely to stay behind more often than not. I think you are far too immature to realize what you are losing in terms of your own patrimony and so forth.
The point which you developed in your lecture yesterday on the phenomenon of the brain drain is a very intriguing one, because as we all know, there is a tremendous brain drain from India and Pakistan to the United States, and more especially to Canada. Canada has even greater appeal than the United States does. With respect to Saudi Arabia, there's virtually no brain drain at all. I suppose you can count on the fingers of one hand the number of Saudis who've studied but who've remained in the United States. And of course, a large number, now some 15,000 Saudis, for example, have taken doctorates in the United States in various fields.
15,000?
About 15,000, a very large number indeed.
But doctorates in what subjects?
Various subjects.
I wouldn't be able to break it down.
No, not in sciences. Very few in sciences.
But you see, they
have
got a very good country. They have got a very good basis for their living and so on.
There's a lot to return to.
What should they do here?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So, the salaries are high, the tribal system is there.
The tribal system is there, looks after them and so forth. And their families are all there and so forth. So why should they return here? Why should they stay here at all? In the case of Indians and Pakistanis who have nothing to go back to, they will stay. But Saudis will not. But the important point which I was pricking my ears when you mentioned Saudis was how many people have come into Saudi Arabia. I've been saying to the Saudis, look, gentlemen, United States built itself up by the dint of getting people from the European countries and taking them in and giving them citizenship. If they were bad citizens, the children are going to be very good citizens. So why don't you do the exactly the same? You may make it a Muslim country. You have a Muslim population, so you may make it so you'll only take Muslims. But take Muslims from all the countries of the world. Don't give them tours of duty of 2 years or 3 years or 1 year. Mostly they give them 1 year appointments. And then they throw them out after a certain period. Now, why should they do that? How many people have migrated into Saudi Arabia? Very, very few. Mm-hmm. That's my real complaint, not Saudi non-migration outside. But it's very good. But how many people have migrated into Saudi Arabia? Very, very few. Because the Saudis will not encourage this. I went to see other Middle Eastern potentates and I put the same questions to them and none of them was able to answer me properly. They all said, well, we have laws which say that the scientists can stay on and so on, but those laws are never implemented.
Well, would the Saudis demand that those who stayed in Saudi Arabia become Wahhabis?
No, no.
They would not?
They would probably, well, I don't know. If they did that, I'm sure I don't worry about Wahhabis, personally. But it's a question of whether they even do that or not. Mm-hmm. But they don't. Saudi nationality, giving Saudi nationality even to an Arab, is supposed to be the last word in kindness. Perhaps it is, but damn it, it can't be more precious than giving a nationality in this country.
It's almost impossible to become a Saudi citizen without having been born in Saudi Arabia.
That's right.
And the same is true in Kuwait and the other Gulf states.
And the other Gulf states. Why? Mm-hmm. Why is that? Why don't they take people for permanent settlement there? Mm-hmm. They would have, of course, a vast number of applications to choose from, but that's part of the whole business. Why should you give them 1 year appointments? You see?
Don't you think it's because they want to guard what they regard as the pristinity of Wahhabi Islamic culture? The holy places of Mecca and Medina and so on, against what they think of as contamination by the outside.
That may be true, but what about Kuwait? They don't have Wahhabi faith in the same way. Mm-hmm. But they behave exactly the same way. You see, or even Iraq, or even Iran, for example. You see, I mean, none of these people have the habit of giving citizenship away. They consider this to be too much of a thing which they would. Even to the Egyptians, for example, even to the Libyans, even to the other Arabs, they will not give anything away.
Has nationalism then become more important than Islam?
Well, this is a question that you should ask. I don't think you couch it in that way, and so far talking with them is concerned. But it is a fact. The fact of the matter is they have never given any citizenship rights to anyone else. I was talking with the Emir of Bahrain the other, about 5 years ago, and I brought up the same question, and again there was no answer.
Mm. Is it possible that these many kingdoms, I could say both the M-A-N-Y and M-I-N-I, the kingdoms that you find in the Arabian Peninsula, that the rulers are simply trying to perpetuate their power in the toward the 21st century?
I think so.
Ruling with almost a medieval Islamic pattern?
I think you're right. Mm-hmm. I think you're right. Well, this is what I was saying last night, that Saudis, for example, have made it an article of faith that science is bad, because it's value-loaded. Science should not be encouraged. Mm-hmm. Technology is neutral, according to them. Technology can do whatever you want it to do, and so on. So technology is fine. Mm-hmm. Technology, you can use technology whether to make new films or whether you make Quran being listened to over the TV, and so on. That's entirely up to you. But science is bad because science will lead to itazal. Itazal being a very, very liberal sort of interpretation of Islam. And then the thought is that Itaz, Mutazila are all apostates or potential apostates. So we, the scientists, are potential apostates. Mm-hmm. And so that's very bad. They do not ask the same question in the same way, in a different way. Why does a scientist become too liberal to ask the question, why should one family corner the whole wealth of a country?
One of the concepts of Islam, which is very highly regarded, is the notion of ijtihad, which means interpretation, and is commonly said by Muslims that this concept is extremely valuable indeed, because it allows for an enormous amount of flexibility and adjustment to new problems which arise, new solutions which arise in the world generally. One very good example of that recently in the case of Saudi Arabia was the trip of Prince Salman on the American space shuttle. And at that time, a number of problems arose with respect to Islam. The first problem was, how would Prince Salman perform ablutions before his prayers 5 times a day? Because on the space shuttle, he could not take large quantities of water or stones or sand, all of which are allowed according to Islamic tradition. The other problem was, how would he say his prayers 5 times a day if he didn't have a prayer rug? Because again, in the space shuttle, he could not take a prayer rug. And then again, how would he determine in space the proper times for saying the prayers and the direction
five
of Mecca?
Times a day, yes.
Now, the rather interesting thing is that under the notion of ijtihad, the religious council headed by Sheikh bin Baz issued a fatwa, which is an edict, as we know,
yes,
indicating that there was sufficient flexibility in Islam so that all of these problems could be met. He did not have to physically perform ablutions if he thought about ablutions. He could do this in spirit, so to speak.
Yes, yes.
He could say his prayers in determine the times in spirit rather by actual chronology.
Yes.
And so the issues were resolved in this way. Now, this seems to me to be a most remarkable concept, a most remarkable flexibility, which has enormous potential in the future for adjustments of Islam to modern science.
Yes.
I wonder if you have any observations about that.
Well, this is, I think you are absolutely right. The ijtihad is one of the most precious things, and this is what I quoted from Dr. Iqbal. His Reconstruction of Islamic Thought is a whole chapter on the subject of ijtihad, and I've quoted that in my talk just to remind people. But it's a very good way to remind people of Sheikh bin Baz's fatwa lately. I didn't know about this particular fatwa, and I'm glad you mentioned this, because this is a very, very important topic which one can bring up in one's thinking and in one's sayings and so forth. So you're absolutely right.
Also, of course, quite impressive is the establishment by the Organization of the Islamic Conference, which embraces some 45 Muslim countries, as we know, and is supported by these 45 Muslim countries. This establishment of the Foundation for Science, Technology and Development, originally headed by Dr. Ali Khatani, who was from Morocco. It seems to me this was a very excellent
idea. Well, you probably don't know that this idea was suggested by myself in 73 to Mr. Bhutto, who was holding the first Islamic conference in Lahore. And he suggested this to the conference itself, and the conference passed it. But then nothing happened since 74. Till 81, when Mr. Ziaul-Haq was the president of Pakistan, and he went to Taif conference, I suggested to him that he take it up again. So he did. And that was the result, that resulted in the conference passing the resolution for creating such an organization. And Ali Khatani was appointed at that time. So Ali Khatani has had his tenure, and he has done some remarkable work, but unfortunately the total amount of funds which were allocated to the business were not $100 million, as I was suggesting, $1,000 million is equal to the Ford Foundation. Mm-hmm. That was my idea, and that's what was suggested by the Lahore conference, but by total of $6 million instead of $1,000 million. So that was the coming down, which poor Khatani had to, if he had $1,000 million, you can imagine what he could have done with it. But he could not do very much more than with the $6 million than he did. But now his tenure is finished and somebody else is to be appointed.
Dr. Saab, you have for a decade or so been really pushing science and technology for the Islamic world, for the rest of the non-Western world, rest of the developing world, so-called.
Yes.
Would you care to make some comments on what is happening in the Islamic world, in the rest of the world, such as Africa, of course, Latin America. What type of success have you had, and what sort of impact is this science and technology gambit doing on the rest of the world?
Well, I think the Latin American situation is much the best of all. That's probably due to the fact that the U.S. is very nearby, and they can send their people to the U.S. and so forth. And also their standard of education is very much higher altogether. To take an example, which was mentioned by Dr. Braibanti in the beginning of his talk, introduction to me, I'm going off to Venezuela after coming here. And the reason is this. The president-elect, Mr. Perez, he was a member of the South Commission with me, and he heard me speak of this subject at the conference in Malaysia, which was held last year, third conference of the South Commission. And there, of course, I put it forward as a failure in our providing an adequate GNP spending on the science and technology issue. For example, we spend 5.6% of our GNP, we, meaning thereby the poor countries of the world, 5.6% of our GNP on defense. 5.6 happens to be exactly the same figure which is spent by the rich countries of the world on defense also. It just happens to be the accidental equality. 3.7% is what we spend on education, 5.1% is what you spend on education. By you, I mean the rich countries of the world. This is again the same sort of figure. 3.7, 5.1 is not very different. When it comes to health, it's a difference of 0.4 versus 1.8%. No, sorry. 1.8% versus 4 point something or the other. 4.6%. So it's a factor of 3 between the two. 2.5 or 3. But when it comes to science and technology, the factor is not 3 or 2 or 1, but it's a factor of 10 or more. Mm. We spend 0.2% as a whole, rising up to 0.3 as a, if you include China and so forth. But you spend 2.5 to 2 to 2.5% of GNP altogether on this subject. So the answer to that question is, science and technology has never been a recognized profession, if you like, within our midst. And that's what I suggested, that this should be corrected, first thing. Now, the economists, of course, don't understand this sort of question. This sort of, they would always like to say that, oh yes, we should try to quantify what exactly you want to do with it, and so forth, so on. For me, it's simply a question of funds, which is very, very important. As you very well know, in the British case, now the funds are rather regulated, and they are going to suffer from this for the future. Anyhow, Perez listened to me, and he came back, and he felt very strongly about this. And he asked me to come through his country when I went to this next meeting of the South Commission, which was in Mexico. So I went to his country in August last year, and there he held a breakfast in my honor, and 50 scientists were collected together, and there he promised that if he is elected, he wasn't yet the president, if he is elected, he would increase his spending in GNP ratios from 0.4, which is what Venezuela spends at the moment, to 2% of GNP, which is a remarkable figure, over 5 years, of course. 2% means if he succeeds even in doing 1%, that will be very, very good. So when he did get elected in 5th of December, his election finished, mm-hmm. First thing he did was he came over to Trieste to tell me of this remarkable formula being put into practice and so forth and so on. So that was very sweet of him. And so now he has invited me and other members of the South Commission to go back to Venezuela at his inauguration on 2nd of February. And at this inauguration ceremony, since there will be all the Latin presidents there, which are already spending fairly high proportions of their GNP on science and technology, even Cuba, for example, is spending 0.9% of its 0.9, which is approaching the 1% figure of its GNP on science and technology, particularly in biotechnology. Would you believe this, that Cuba has a very strong biotechnological input, very, very strong. The apparently Castro is very keen to show all his visitors the biotechnological centers which they have developed. And biotechnology is supposedly a very good word in Cuba. So I hope that I shall meet all the presidents of Latin America and hope to be able to influence them to proclaim this 2% figure, like the other president, like the president of Venezuela has done already, to be the norm in Latin America. So Latin America probably may very well be well catered for. Likewise, the countries of the Confucian Belt, like South Korea, Taiwan, the countries of Singapore, even Malaysia, and even Philippines, have decided to spend much more of their GNP, and of course the number of people who are trained is very much larger. And for example, take South Korea. South Korea is at the moment spending 2% of its GNP. 2% of its GNP is at the moment being spent. And they plan to increase it to 3% by the year 1992. 3%. I remember going to South Korea some time ago. I didn't tell the story yesterday, but I would like to tell it now. And the first thing which happened was, they took me to the, this was 2 years ago, I think, I was in South Korea, and the first thing which happened was, they took me from the airport to the, straight to the TV studios. And at the TV studios, they wanted to know, they said to me the following question. They said, we have made it a part of national policy that we shall win Nobel Prizes. Can you give us some hints about this? Now, this sounded rather ridiculous. And I said, so, but I was very pleased with this whole idea of their having made it a part of their national policy. Mm-hmm. Because this means that they'll provide literature to the people, they'll provide good facilities to the people, and they'll provide all the wherewithal which goes with scientific research. And so they are living up to it. They told me they had made it a part of their national policy, that they'll beat Pakistan in hockey, they'll beat China in ping pong, and they did both of them. They did both of them at the very next Asian Olympics, you see. And so this shouldn't be laughed at, of course, but still. Mm-hmm. Anyway, this is South Korea. Taiwan is similar. Taiwan is spending a large proportion of its fraction of its GNP, similarly Singapore. So, but it seems to be a Chinese Confucian belt, what I call Confucian belt, Japan and so forth, Confucian belt tradition, which is probably due to psychology, to the sociological factors. You may know this better. I'd like you to hear your comments about this. But it may very well be because somehow or other the fact that you are not acting as individuals but as a team is somehow strongly emphasized in Confucian tradition. I don't know what the reason is, but this is a fact. Now, India is doing quite well, but Pakistan and South and is not doing so well, and Bangladesh are not doing so well, Sri Lanka is not doing so well. When we come to the Middle East, that's doing quite poorly, regretfully, quite poorly. And when we come to Africa, that's doing very, very poorly indeed. So it's a different parts of the world have a different sort of figures to boast about. And I'm afraid I was a little pessimistic when I spoke of yesterday in my speech. I spoke of the there being no hope for Islamic or Arab or African countries. So far as science and technology is concerned, there's no hope, at least on the future immediate horizon. Mm-hmm. But there being hope for Latin America and Confucian belt countries of Southeast Asia. So that's the situation that prevails now in the developing world. But someday, I'm sure, the penny will drop. And for example, in Iran, I was very well. I was there 2 months ago, but in the middle of November. And Iran was very surprisingly, although it's a mullah country, And it's surprisingly, the reception which I received was very, very tremendous. They are talking of 2% now. They haven't yet done it, but they are talking of 2%. And the talk means that they are very serious about it. Although it's not well known, I may make an interjection here, it's not well known that out of the 24-member cabinet, 23 are non-mullahs. 23 are non-mullahs. It's not well known. They are all technicians, including the Prime Minister, Prime Minister Dawood. They are not mullahs.
Perhaps you might explain that term mullah and the whole psychology of the mullah for us.
Well, perhaps you should tell it to the public yourself, what you think of the word mullah.
Well, it is a kind of mentality, isn't it? It's a kind of an extremely parochial mentality of mullahs who were trained largely in Quranic learning. They know only the Quran.
Yes.
They know very little else. And almost all Muslim countries have struggled with the problem of how to elevate the horizon, so to speak, of the mullah.
That's right, that's right.
To get them to understand the world
that's
at large right. and to that's get them right. to understand something in addition to the literal interpretation of the Holy Quran, which
yes,
is what
yes,
they
yes.
use. And the mullah mentality means arguing almost endlessly over extreme minutiae a religious doctrine. It's almost like the early Christian scholasticism of how many angels will fit on the point of the needle. I don't know whether I've described them correctly, but is that...
You described them absolutely correctly. But the mullahs in Iran, for example, now, having tasted of power and having lived through a power struggle and so forth, are now very different people. They are much more educated, much more with it in the world, worldly sense and so forth. And for example, they're giving up power in this way, which is not very well publicized, is itself a very, very important point. The majority in the majlis now is not mullahs at all. The majority in the majlis is really technocrats and people with degrees and so on. I was very heartily impressed with Iran, I must say. Very heartily impressed with Iran. It's a very fine place, and I think it has a great future. It had a great future, as you very well know, in Islamic days. Out of 350 years where Islamic learning was the supreme number one in the world, between the years of 700 and 1050 AD, 250 can be attributed to Iranian influence. Mm-hmm. 250 out of 350 is a very large number, very large period, you see. Mm-hmm.
Would you be equally impressed by Iraq, by Baghdad, and the potential for Iraq?
I've not been there. Mm-hmm. I've not been there. So, but before the war, of course, Iraqis had begun to come to Trieste in very large numbers, mm-hmm. very, very large numbers. Mm-hmm. And they're very mature people. They have, for example, they had for, at that time, I don't know what's happened now, at that time they had the good fortune of making scientific, if you wrote a scientific paper, you were able to import a car. It's a very good way of, that's true, it's true. You see, you were able to import a Volvo. Volvo meant you became rich instantly. If you wrote one scientific paper, which is published elsewhere.
That's your motivation there.
That's his motivation, mm-hmm. yes.
Certainly would be.
Yes.
You mentioned Trieste. That brings me to points that I wanted to ask you about. Your great success in building up the International Center for Theoretical Physics there. And to a great extent, the people who come to that center
yes,
come from
yes.
these countries that we've been talking about.
Yes,
I wonder
yes.
if you could describe the process by which they're chosen, what they do, and what they do when they leave.
Yes, well, that's a very good question. You see, the center was created in 1964 against the opposition of USA, USSR, UK, France, Germany. All the rich countries of the world were against it because they didn't understand what I was talking about. And this was quite clearly stated by the Australian delegate who said quite frankly, he said, ladies and gentlemen, what Professor Salam is talking about is theoretical physics. Now, theoretical physics happens to be the Rolls Royce of sciences. What the developing countries need is donkey carts. That's what the Australian delegate speaking.
The old story.
Old story. And I think my good friend Smythe, who has now died, you probably know him very well, knew him very well. He was the delegate from the USA at that meeting, and I remember getting all the poor countries to vote for us. And I mean, at the time, Afghanistan to get up and say, "Oh, we want theoretical physics," was a remarkable thing. Mm-hmm. Absolutely remarkable. So we got 60 votes to his 20, and we beat them down. But they didn't help us, because in the end, the money, which is the real thing which makes an institute grow up or not, was voted by the Board of Governors. And the Board of Governors was again packed with the same set of rich countries. So we got $55,000 net for a year from the agency, atomic agency, where the debate was taking place, to set up a center. $55,000 net. So we had to go around and ask for money, and we did. The Italians were the most forthcoming of all people, because they wanted to build up Trieste. Trieste was a place which had a whole history of being in the forefront of this free city and so forth, and they had made a bid for UNESCO, which had been beaten down, and then they wanted to build up something else, and so they chose me and so forth. So the Italian government produced $350,000, $350,000 plus 55, which we got from the agency, and that with $400,000 we started the center. So for a number of years it remained at that sort of level, a level of misery and so on. Till 1979, when I got the Nobel Prize, and then I went to the Italians and I said, "I'm going to leave you." They said, "Why?" I said, "You only give me $0.7 million. $0.7 million. This I can get now from anywhere." So we started to bargain. And the bargain, they said, "What do you want?" I said, "I want $3.5 million. 3.5 times as much from you." So by this time, the agency had increased its money to $1 million. The agency, the atomic agency, and the UNESCO had increased its contribution to $500,000. And the Italians were being asked to produce 3.5. So we started the bargaining at 2 and we finished at 3. Mm-hmm. But since that time, Mr. Andreotti, who has been the foreign minister of Italy, he came to Trieste himself. And they have been very, very generous, and they have been increasing their contribution by $1 million each year. And so now we stand at about $15 million altogether. Mm-hmm. Out of this $15 million, sir, we get 4,000 people a year from the whole world. Of these 4,000, 1,500 are from developing countries, and 2,500 are from the rich countries. We cover all disciplines of physics, not just particle physics. We cover all disciplines of physics, meaning thereby the solid state physics is the biggest community which comes to us. And they are, in Europe certainly, it's a very important place for European physics and so forth. So what do they do, these people who come to us? Well, for example, a typical course may very well be on ionosphere, let's say. Ionosphere. Now, ionosphere would attract all the Africans. The African countries are somehow gone in for ionosphere in a very big way. Gone in, when I say gone in, that means they have men trained in ionosphere. Whenever the training was taking place, they sent people out for ionospheric studies. Mm-hmm. So they have got good people, but they haven't got any equipment. Mm-hmm. So what do? We call these people in. There'll be 80 people for a course, of them maybe 50 are from developing countries and 30 are lecturers plus people from the rich countries and so on. We pay all the 50, all their travel, all their stay there. We do not pay anything to those from the developed countries. So these people would come for 6 months, for 3 months, 2 months, 1 month, depending on what the course is. And they will then stay that while we would try very hard to get them the equipment, if we can, from either the Italians or from begging and borrowing or from CERN in Geneva or from US even. And U.S. is now very much a strong supporter of the whole center. Strong supporter, I should say, not the aid department yet, but the atomic energy department, the Department of Energy, mm-hmm. for example, has been very strongly supporting us. So then we would try to get them funds or equipment or something to take back home when they go back. And almost everybody, I should say almost, 100% is the figure with which they go back. Mm-hmm. There's no question of anybody trying to leave from Trieste or make a defection from Trieste. There's no brain drain whatsoever. It's because these are men who are already employed, they're well settled, they have their families and so on, and they are there just for a short period anyway. So they go back, and then they have the opportunity of coming back again and again to Trieste. That's a very big incentive for the anti-brain drain device. My feeling is that brain drain happens because people, certainly scientists are more attracted to go outside because of their lack of literature or because of their lack of facilities or because of their lack of contact and so forth. If you cure those things, then you are really in good shape. So that's what we try to do very strongly. And then the new thing which has happened now is that we have been charged. I went to Mr. Andriotti again last year, on 5th of February, I remember. And I said to him, look, Mr. Andriotti, I've got 10 more years of life in me. Why don't you use me now to build up new centers? He said, what two centers you suggest? I said to him, one center on high technology and new materials, high temperature superconductivity and composite materials, one center on earth sciences and earth's environment, and one center on chemistry pure and applied. And this together with the old center will together make up what we shall call International Center for Science. He said, how much money will you need? I said, $10 million for each center. He said, go ahead. So what we have been doing last year is to draw up a plan with 7 meetings which we have held between the Italian and the developing country for scientists and so forth in all these 3 disciplines, 2 meetings each, with the final meeting being the Nobel laureates meeting, if you like, so as to give the whole thing a prestige. And I shall present, as soon as I get back from here, I shall present this report to Mr. Andriotti and get his blessings for $10 million, if I can. And since these centers, the new centers, are going to be purely technological, not like theoretical physics, so I hope I can ask the 8 people here, and in the UK, and in France, and in Holland, and in Sweden, and so forth, all the good donor countries, to contribute directly to the sum of money. And this is why I was being so much against the 8 department people. I've been calling them morons, just to make them angry. They feel they can look upon this whole thing rather more carefully, and I hope they'll like it, and they'll contribute to it. So if you ever see any of the 8 department people, tell them that it's coming to them.
The people who go back from Trieste back to their countries, are these mostly university professors?
Yes,
not? They are
almost all of them.
Have you had the experience of having them send you their students yet, or has the center been in existence long enough for that to happen?
The center's been in existence for 25 years, yeah, so that we should get the students.
Yes.
But the competition is so heavy for places to come to Trieste that usually we find, quite often we find, that the head of the department gets our invitations. And he keeps them himself, for himself. He does not let it.
It's too precious.
Too great.
I see. During this time that you were establishing this center, this was the time, roughly the time, in which you were working on the electroweak series, electroweak interactions. How in the world did you find time to, do this important work?
This was very good period because, you remember, this was done in 67, 68.
Yes.
And 67, 68, the center was still rather young and small. Mm-hmm. And we were able to... let me tell you the story of how I was concerned with the electroweak theory. You probably know John Ward very well.
Yes.
Was he here?
No, but I was a student at Johns Hopkins, and he was at Maryland, and he came to our seminar.
Yes. He and I together started the whole idea of this business of combining electricity with electricity magnetism with the weak nuclear forces. And during 63, 64, when Higgs was busy with his ideas of his von after symmetry breaking, I imported those ideas together with Weinberg into this whole area. And this was completed by 67, 68. And 67, 68, then after that, you probably remember, 73 is the next date when the things started to happen at the CERN laboratory. Yeah. Neutral currents were discovered. Yes. They were discovered and 73 was still, the center was still quite small. And then the last set of experiments were done at Stanford in 78, you remember. When just before the center was, when the Prescott and Taylor and these people discovered the interference of Z0 with the photons and so forth.
Yes.
So I remember, let me tell you a story at this point of Taylor, John, of Taylor, who was one of the people who was involved in this experiment. I rang him up from Trieste at about 10 o'clock at night to give him about 10 hours to catch him at lunchtime. I got him through and I said, you did the experiments yesterday, what's the results? He said, well, we should have told you all the results, but the trouble with us is now that today we have 60 reporters besieging the laboratory and we have sworn every one of us, 40 people were involved in the experiment, 40 of us have sworn, taken oath, not to divulge the results of the experiment till tomorrow when we give the official seminar. What shall we do with you? I said, well, like an honorable man, I said, how can you tell me? Of course you can't tell me. Then he heard the disappointment in my voice. He said, what time is it in Trieste? I said, it's 10 o'clock at night. He said, is that your sleeping time? I said, yes. He said, well, all I can tell you is, go to sleep and sleep well. So this is how I learned this.
That's wonderful.
The experiment has succeeded.
A small hint.
Small hint, yes. Sleep well. I don't know if he remembers the story. I'll probably remind him this time when I see him. But anyway, that was the time when the center was rather relatively small.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to commute between that and Imperial College. And most of my work was done at Imperial College.
Mm-hmm.
Because, as you probably know, Higgs is a Scottish scientist. Or may well be that I was thinking of yesterday's announcement by Scotland of this first prize for, first medal for, what is it, Science Fair.
Science Fair, yes.
Yes, I was thinking that Higgs should be the next one.
Mm-hmm.
Higgs is a very good Scottish physicist who has done this piece of work which he used. And so in that sense, electroweak theory, electroweak incidentally is a name which I invented.
Yes, I know.
You know that?
Yes.
Well, not many people know that. Yeah, I invented that name and I tried to sell it to a Weinberg at 78 conference in the Tokyo.
Yes.
I said, electroweak is a good name, simple name, which will... He said, no, let's keep it electricity and magnetism unified with the nuclear forces and so on. He was not very partial to that, but later on it caught on. And. The other names all died out. So that's the story of electroweak unification.
A very exciting time.
Well, since then I've been more excited by the effect of trying to get this science and technology area spoken about in the developing countries, and I've not met with the same success.
Mm-hmm.
Except for Latin America, I hope. This time it will be a breakthrough, I hope, very much.
The science and technology, you keep emphasizing both. However, I, from my experience with many of our foreign assistance programs, these programs that we have, and of course most of the other so-called developed countries have in the developing world, an emphasis is on technology primarily. But are you of the opinion that you can separate science and technology and really move ahead?
Well, the point is, technology is a very, very bad phrase because it's meant to cover all sorts of things. What one should clearly distinguish is four areas of science and technology, two areas of science and two of technology. These four areas are the following. Number one is the basic sciences, which we do not emphasize at all in our developing country or in any of the aid programs or whatever, because we believe that like the Japanese, we shall take over all the basic sciences from the developed world, and that we need not produce anything. The result of that is that we don't even have good people to refer to in our own countries. You need at least a man at the end of a telephone line whom you can ask questions. Will I do this? Will this work? What is your assessment of it? We don't have such people. That's the least part of the difficulty which we have. So this is the first thing which we have to correct. So technology transfer is not science transfer. This is science, the word science simply does not occur, for example, in the Brandt Commission report. You read about Brandt Commission. The Brandt Commission report does not contain the word science at all. It's only technology transfer it talks about. So the second area of science is applied sciences, which is agriculture, which is environment, which is energy, which is pollution, and so forth. These are not technology transfers. This technology transfer is loosely applied to this area, but it's wrong to say it's technology transfer because it's a good applied science.
Agriculture. Green revolution would come under that category.
You see, that's good applied science. What was the Green Revolution? You know that.
The Los Baños, and the Philippines
and the Mexican things. Well, what they did was they had this plant which was resistant, which was not lodging over, which was not going down with its heavy stems and
stalk,
so on.
Stood up straight, short stalk
and so on. But this was not done on a genetic basis as we would do it today. It was still done by the old techniques of hit and miss. But still, they knew what they wanted, and they were carefully producing that thing. But now, of course, it will be done much more quickly, or should be done much more quickly. So that's applied science. Then we come to the area of low technology. Low technology meaning thereby the technology of the 20s or 30s or whatever have you, where iron, steel, and bulk chemicals, large amount of. Now this is an area which must be done, like basic sciences, by everybody. You have to make iron and steel, but not in such large quantities as you used to think. One used to, the communist countries all went straight for iron and steel technologies, which is not the case today, because iron and steel is not needed so much. As you very well know, you need fibers and so forth. Carbon fibers and so forth are needed and so on. Then there's the area of high technology, which is where the money is today. And that's the area which includes, for example, electronics, which includes space sciences, which includes fine chemicals, which includes biotechnology. So these are the areas of composite materials and so on. These are areas where science is needed. Again, science is needed. So science is three areas: basic sciences, applied sciences, and high technology. So and that's the distinction which should be made quite clearly today. And if one begins to make that distinction, if it gets through to the aid departments, they'll begin to understand what we are talking about. At the moment, everything is called technology transfer. It's totally absurd.
Yes, sometimes the AID people involve two categories, hard technology and soft technology.
Yes.
They even think in terms of education, for example, government administration,
yes,
theories of economic development. They refer to this as soft technology, as against the hard technologies involving...
what I call low and high technology.
Yes, or what some people, I myself have called a larger proportion of what we call somatic skills, engineering, building the bridges and so on.
So what you are saying is that I have not included in my categorization what you would call soft technology,
thereby meaning
political science and your subject and things like that.
Law would be a soft technology, administration would be another.
Well, this is...
On the assumption that each of them does have a paradigm, there is a paradigmatic dimension to them, so they become technologies in that sense. I'm not sure this is a good classification,
no,
but it's one which is commonly used.
Very poor classification.
And quite erroneous, I think, yes.
Quite erroneous, yes. I think this fund should be calling them law and political politics and so on, and sociology and so on. Sociology, of course, is a very big role. For example, and one of the examples which I consider in my booklet is the example of whether we should go in for export industries or this industrialization we are talking about, or whether one should think of import substitution. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a very important economics problem, whether one should go in for export. For example, the South Korean Minister of Science says that they consciously went on for export rather than import substitution. Import substitution was the communistic thinking, while export industries was something which the free world likes much better. Now, of course, USA doesn't like it so much, but that's a separate issue.
But don't you think that the great risk with respect to importing any kind of technology is the ultimate destruction of the individual culture? It could bring about the ultimate destruction of Islamic culture.
I thought you were going to say destruction of the environment. That is true.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But culture, no. There I totally disagree with you. Mm-hmm. Because take the Japanese culture. What has been destroyed? The Japanese, as soon as he goes home, changes into his kimono.
Mm-hmm. Sits on the tatami.
Cross-legged, I suppose. And he sits, he is just totally Japanese. What's happened to his culture? Nothing, to my knowledge. Maybe they feel they've lost something. But the loss is very much smaller than having a filled belly, damn it. So I think this culture business is highly overrated. Mm-hmm. Environment, yes. You can very well say that technologies are going to wreck the environment. And particularly, not only the physicists were blamed for this atomic weapons, but now it seems the chemists are going to wreck the environment much sooner than the physicists are going to. Physicists have been overtaken by Gorbachev and so on. And so forth, and but the chemists are totally rogue elephants, if you wish.
What do you think is the future of nuclear power? Because there are certain elements in the world who argue that nuclear power is self-defeating in the long run.
I'm afraid this is where I disagree with these people. I think the nuclear power has to come. What we should be really doing is to make nuclear, because even Sweden, take Sweden for example, which had the law that said no more nuclear power stations. But they haven't had the strength to close down the ones which have been built already. Because the world needs electricity and there's no other electric. Even coal has been found out now by chemists destroying the environment through the use of coal, fossil fuels. So I'm afraid nuclear power is going to come. Whether it comes in the present form or in the form of fusion or what have you is something which is to be debated. But it has to be, it has to come.
What is the relative situation in the developing countries with respect to their sources of energy? If they are to achieve industrialization, then one needs a certain amount of energy, and
right.
I know they differ in the availability of water power and things
I think there the U.S. has certainly not done this. Mr. Reagan was very, very bad in this respect, because he stopped the program for the use of solar power. Mm-hmm. He thought solar power was just nonsense, which is wrong. He should have emphasized solar power much more than he did. For example, the solar laboratories were starved of funds, and the solar laboratories were not given their head and so forth. Now that's something where the US certainly can take a lead. And if it takes a lead, then we shall all go for solar power, because we have plenty of solar power available.
Plenty of sunshine.
Plenty of sunshine available. So I think solar power is going to be very, very important in the future, if you ask me. Because it's a clean power and not polluting and so forth and so on. So in that sense, I'm afraid the U.S. has not done a good deed.
the name of the game always seems to have been, through time, even in the prehistoric periods, if we look at it carefully, is energy.
Yes.
Is energy. Yes. And so this evolving energy concepts that the world has and that you are pushing constantly with your science and technology.
That's right.
Should be in the forefront of virtually every country, not simply the developed world, but that's the right. developing that's world, that's which right. is your that's main right. that's concern right. at this time.
Well, the developing world will not, for example, take solar energy, will not be able to make enough use of it because of the fact that applied science is not being so highly pursued in our countries. If we were given the head, if we had the possibility of doing applied science, possibly, we might have developed as well as the US would have done the solar power. But we don't have the money or the donation or so on to be able to devote as much funds. For example, Dr. Kissinger, at the Nairobi conference in 1969, was it? When was the Nairobi conference? 79, I don't remember. 78, I think. 78. He promised, was he Secretary of State then?
I think so, yes.
I think he was Secretary of State at that time. He promised the world several institutions. Several institutions of the type which included solar energy institution from the US as a gift. He promised that he would have an institution which would look at the transfer of technology, as it was called then, in solar energy, in various other disciplines, and particularly in terms of information center for various technologies. Nothing whatsoever happened after he gave up. So I went to him in 82 when he was a member of the Moroccan Academy. He came to Moroccan Academy and I went to him and I said to him, what's happening to your suggestions then? He had by then left off his job. He said, well, write to me. I wrote to him. I got an acknowledgement and that's about all. So that's the unfortunate part of it. Technology somehow doesn't excite even science. Or technology, both of them, don't excite anybody. It's a funny thing to me, very, very funny thing to me. Can you explain this? Why does it not excite people? I mean, I know there's a lobby here which is against technology, which is, but somehow or other it's some, well, whereas you here in the state have done very well, you as you were showing me yesterday. IBM is here and
Research Triangle Park
is very well done.
Yes.
Yeah. But somehow or other doesn't translate itself to other parts of the world. I don't know why it is.
There's a large component of private entrepreneurial activity responsible in this country.
In this country.
For science and technology at that level.
Yes.
Not for high energy physics, of course,
yes,
but for these other things.
Yes.
And there are those, I'm not going to argue this myself, but there are those who think that entrepreneurial activity is probably a necessary element
yes.
in the scheme of things. Is there any way to introduce that entrepreneurial element in the
age? Literally not. Because we don't have the... Well, Singapore has shown that this can be done. Mm-hmm. Singapore is very well, as you know. Mm-hmm. But you need a firm hand of the guidance of the state somehow. In our countries, people have got so used to state being the father of everything that purely entrepreneurial enterprise is not going to be the final verdict in our countries, I'm afraid.
The entrepreneur understands well enough that the control of energy is a valuable thing.
Does he?
I think they do.
They do. But are they going to ask for the revival of those laboratories which the Reagan administration killed off?
Well, they don't understand the science at the level that you and I do it, but they do understand it at this next level.
No, but they should know exactly that unless they have the input from the fundamental laboratories, which are making liquid crystals or what have you, they're going to be beaten by the Japanese, thank God for that. Yeah. Thank God for that, I said.
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, Japan is another example of the entrepreneurial
enterprise.
Enterprise.
Yes.
And
working hand in glove with the government,
though. Hand in glove with the government, yes. With the MITI, MITI organization, which so, sponsors them very with the large donations and large sums of money and so on, and charts out the whole activities as they will be in the next 5 years. So it's a question of not just entrepreneurial enterprise, but a mixture of the two. And that mixture can be blessed like Japan is, or it need not be blessed like other countries and so forth. But we have very uphill jobs, really, because we have this. Everybody, when you go to them, they say, well, what about the food problem, what about the problem of health and so on. And what do you say to that? You simply point out that if you do science and technology in the way I am saying, that's a point which perhaps I should make more clearly in the future. Examples thereby that you will get more GNP, or the increase in GNP which will accrue from that sort of. Perhaps one should give examples of green revolutions and things like that, and energy and so forth, which is very, very important to understand. May well be that that's what's been lacking in our expositions that we talk of. I'm always accused, as you may imagine, well imagine, Dr. Evans, of being always imposing on science, basic sciences. Mm-hmm. I'm always accused of particle physics, which is ridiculous. I'm a particle physicist at one time, but at the other times I'm not a particle physicist. I'm not talking about particle physics. If you come into Trieste, you will see that particle physics is only 10% of the whole operation now.
An unfair question.
Yes.
With your involvement, as it has been for so long, in the spread of science and technology,
yes.
What do you predict for the next decade as far as the developing world is concerned?
Well, as I said before, I do not predict very well anything for the Islamic or the Arab or the African countries. I do not predict very much. I think they'll be as miserable as they are, have always been.
And you, but you shall continue to...
I shall continue.
...your crusade to try to get a change. As
well, of course, that's part of life, you see. And that's something which I shall continue. There's no question about that.
Well, we wish you good fortune in this very important crusade which you've undertaken. This
yes.
has been a very stimulating conversation for the three of us from Duke University. And I reiterate that we're very honored indeed to have you visit us and to take your time to be with us. This has been one of a series of conversations with the distinguished visitors who come to the Duke campus in a program which is known as the Living History Program. And as I said at the very beginning, our distinguished visitor, Dr. Abdus Salam, a Nobel Prize laureate, is on his way to Venezuela, where he'll be pursuing this remarkable and important interest of his. And again, we thank you very much for this.
Thank you. That's very sweet of you, but I would like some tapes of this conversation, if that's possible.
I think we'll have to take it up
yes.
with those who are
yes.
in charge of this,
yes.
but.
Yes.
I'm sure it is possible.
Yes, yes, good. Thank you very much. And it's been very stimulating for me because I've come across for the first time people from the first world who have given me inputs which are very important for my own crusade. For example, this whole idea of this emphasizing much more the successes of science and technology in various areas is very mm-hmm. important for me to understand and act upon in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, it would be very difficult, I think, wouldn't it, to prove the precise relationship between basic science
oh, yes,
and, let's
right.
say, such problems in public health as infant mortality and,
that's
and
right.
of
that's
course,
right.
birth control, starvation and the like.
That's right.
One wouldn't be able to come up with as many cases like the whole Erie Rice,
that's
the Green
right.
Revolution, which
that's
is
right.
that's a very dramatic that's and spectacular instance.
Well, even that is not.